The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Nimonik's EHS and Quality webinar series. This webinar will touch upon the operational challenges electronic recyclers face and the solutions, a lot on common non-conformances during certification audits like R2, E-Steward, ISO 14001, OSAS 18001, and then a bit on the upcoming trends in the electronics recycling industry. Before we dive into the topic, I would quickly introduce myself and our expert today. I'm Jessica. I'm the head of marketing at Nimonik. Nimonik is a web and mobile app created to help you create and maintain your legal registers or compliance obligations, as they are now called, and stay compliant with requirements at all times, wherever in the world you might be located. Nimonik's mobile auditing app helps EHS professionals conduct audits simply, efficiently, and thoroughly with or without internet. Our expert today is Ronald Lepore, who is a former RQO lead auditor. RQO is the official body in Canada that certifies electronics recyclers. So no better person than him to ask your questions regarding common non-conformances and how to avoid them for your next audit. Please feel free to send me your questions in the chat now or anytime during the presentation. Ronald will answer questions in the sequence received, but at the end of the presentation. And it would be great to have the question and answer session as interactive as possible, so please do not hesitate to ask Ronald your questions. Just two more things before we begin. Ronald wrote a couple of articles on electronics recycling. We have compiled the links of all the articles for you to read at your convenience. The PDFs are available in the handout section for you to download anytime during the presentation. Secondly, if you have to leave before the presentation ends, it's not a problem since we would be sending out the recording to all the registrants. I highly encourage you to share the knowledge with your colleagues and friends or whoever is interested, but please take a moment to answer seven simple multiple choice questions when you exit the webinar. It would just help us improve to provide you with better and more relevant content for future webinars. You can also find the recordings of our past webinars on a variety of EHS topics on the website. I highly recommend EHS professionals looking for continuing education to check out the webinars as well as a blog and newsletter every month, which are full of carefully chosen valuable information. The presentation will be around 40 to 45 minutes, after which we will answer as many questions as possible until the end. So that's all for the introductions. I'm happy to say that we have attendees from all over the world joining us today. Thank you so much for participating. And without further ado, here is our expert, Ronald Lepore.
Thank you, Jessa, for the introduction. I guess I'm old and new to this. Essentially, as a former RQO auditor, I was instrumental in approving electronic recyclers under the Canadian standards, including downstream suppliers. I am a lead auditor in 14001, 9001, 2015 standards, as well as the OSHA 18001 standard, which is developing into ISO 45000 in the next little while. Basically, this webinar is going to give you a little bit of a viewpoint from an auditor's point of view and also from somebody who has been in the business. I think quite a few of you will be able to recognize the challenges, recognize some of the non-conformances, and hopefully I'm here to give you a little bit of an overview as to what are the best ways to get around some of these issues. And also sharing among either top-end recyclers to the very smallest amount of individuals on a small scale basis. So I'm hoping that it is useful for most of the individuals here on this webinar, since basically we all have been into this industry together. One of the agenda today is the overview of North American recycling programs, and I'll be covering the US and Canada, how it developed, but what are the non-conformances during certification audits that we see, some of the operational operational challenges. And that's very specific. I'm not going to get into actual operations, but I'm going to get into why are things changing on the operational side. Some of the current trends that we're foreseeing in the next little while, and also on the legal requirements. As far as Section 1, which we have as an overview here, is the EPRA Canadian programs versus US. I think we have been seeing the EPRA Canadian across from east to west. It started off in Alberta, went to BC, all the way down to Halifax. There have been some changes recently in Ontario, and I'm going to be discussing that as part of the program. I'm sure that individuals do have certain questions concerning that. And we'll also see on the U.S. side, all the brown states that have programs. So we're seeing that about 50% of the U.S. states are in a standardized process as far as some type of regulation concerning electronic recycling. In Canada, it started off since 2004, the electronic recycling standard, which basically was pushed off with Cliff Hacking and Jay Illingworth as far as ways to harmonize this throughout Canada. I think they were very instrumental on this, and also created of the RQO, which is the Recycling Qualification Office, in order to maintain audits of electronic recyclers through Canada, approve them, and make sure that they are ready to get into the system. One note about that is that in approval of electronic recyclers didn't necessarily guarantee that they were going to get into any contracts. It was a prerequisite to get into either Quebec, Ontario, BC, etc. You had to pass this phase. And then, you know, it's a scenario like if you build it, they will come. Well, not necessarily. You may pass this, but your contracts, delegation, allocations may not be what you have anticipated either. So there was still some reorganization there to consider as far as getting into this type of industry. In the U.S., they have lagged behind Canada, and I think it was just a matter of development more than anything else. Legislations are still not harmonized across the U.S. right now. It's very easy for individual corporations to transfer materials from one state to the other into a non-regulated state. And we're starting to see that with the possibility of difficulties in seeing and finding downstreamers for specific commodities, that, you know, it'd be very easy to transfer to developing countries, et cetera, through these states and basically not have the traceability. So this has always been an issue in the recycling industry. That's the reason why R2 came about as well, in order to standardize across North America, including Europe. And R2 was also involved a little differently, because under the Canadian programs, what they had to do is they had to go out and audit recyclers. They had to audit the downstream right to end of life. And this became quite a charge to most of the auditors in that department, since it was very limited resources. So a natural development for the RQO was to incorporate R2 into their standards, eliminating a lot of the resource structures that we're looking at and the costs that we associated, that, you know, if you're R2, then basically you have passed all these. We don't really have to go into depth about, it's almost like ISO, and the foundation of the EPRA side of it was based on ISO 14001. So it was a natural development that they had their constraints. The next step was to get ISO 14001, which covers the environmental side, to show us that you had a management system in place. And the qualifications of the downstreamers was quite taxing for these for this department. So R2 has come in basically to settle and standardize a certain requirement within the Canadian structure, which also is easier to go out and actually approve downstreamers and qualified downstreamers if they are already R2, which is a good possibility in the US, since I think R2 is more viable than the E-Stewart's certification. I think there's situations that you have to look at as far as cost, how you join E-Stewart's, the cost factor based on volume, and also the constraints over shipping out material overseas. It was a natural development. As far as the next section goes, I'm going to be discussing some of the non-conformities from an auditor's point of view, and I think a lot of you would relate to this. But I'm sharing the approach of an auditor walking in, and an RQO auditor or an ISO auditor, what is the starting point? And usually we're going to be looking at significant aspects. We're going to be looking at hazardous materials and health and safety. We're going to be looking at housekeeping, the security of the building, contingency and closure plans, and emergency preparedness and response. There are other areas, of course, that auditors do look at, and it would be management review. How are you reviewing your structures, et cetera? But I think a lot of the non-conformances arise in these areas. Whether it's an ISO 9000, whether it's 14000, whether it's R2, whether it's E-Stewart's, I'm pretty well sure that most of the non-conformances are evolved within these six areas. So, on the first concern for ISO 14001 or R2, the starting point from any auditor is a significant aspects. Which these aspects of activities can be controlled within a life cycle. So we're looking at the significant aspects to approach. One on the environmental side, what's important, what are the hazardous areas, materials that are being done, the operations. And also, you can't forget about the health and safety side. So we're looking at the risk assessments as well, okay? But there was a very good new development on ISO 14000. 2001, which interfaces very well with R2, it's a life cycle approach. And this is a way basically to evaluate how an organization interfaces with its significant aspects, as well as providing the scope of operations of a corporation in the recycling business. Could be recycling, could be OEMs, products, manufacturers. But as you see the life cycle here, there are two big circles. One is, how can I influence this life cycle of this product that I'm dealing with? And what are the control areas? So if we take on a manufacturing basis, from extraction of raw materials to purchasing, manufacturing, distribution, use, and disposal, we can also take that snapshot and use it in a recycling aspects. We do go through these phases, right? And we do go through phases where we can influence. We go through phases that where we actually have to control. And on the control side, it's atmospheric emissions, liquid effluents, okay? The liquid side, certainly ethylene glycol, okay? It could be spillage, could be diesel fuel, possibly in shipping areas that are discharged, hydraulic fluid from forklifts, okay? In the atmosphere, your dust collector system, because we do have lead dust. And whether you are a primary recycler with a shredding situation or normal teardown line, there's always a potential for lead dust, if not lead dust, beryllium, cadmium, etc. But this whole life cycle approach is embedded in the ISO 14001. And it's a very good starting point. Also, what we have to understand is, when we are looking at significant aspects and control points and everything else, there's certainly areas of continuous improvement. How does management deal with recurring changes, okay? And the foundation to this is the PDCA approach. This PDCA approach has been modified to show 2015 approach of the context of the organization on the plan, do, check, act. What's involved here? Since the 2015 has come up, there are now 10 sections, and there's 10 sections in 9000, 14000. There will be 10 sections in the new ISO 45000. And the only section that really changes pertinent to whatever standard you're dealing with is number 8, which is the operations. And this goes into your control points. How do you operate your processes, et cetera, which are different for each standard, okay? But the context of the organization is who you are. What is your scope of operations? What is your interfacing with interested parties? So this approach from an auditor's perspective is important. It should also be an approach that you're using on day-to-day activities within the plant, on your planning, your process changes, your change management side. And there are issues that come out with this change management approach, because what I've seen in a lot of cases, what you see there is an example of a grid used for controlling significant aspects or aspects evaluation, okay? And it's based on RPN numbers, which is risk priority numbers, and goes back to really the failure mode and effects analysis, the FEMAs that we use on either design or process. And that certainly goes back to Six Sigma operations and the automotive industry. But what we're looking at is, how are these aspects controlled and associated with legal regulations? But we're one of the failures that we've seen is that when you're doing your risk analysis, you're using basically before control points. And you're saying, okay, where most people fail is that they're getting a number before the control points, but they don't have a number after the control points. So it's important that we deal with an approach as to what are you using before condition, normal conditions that we have in place. What are we controlling? What are your control points, which are basically could be work instructions, it could be specific operations that are poke-yoked into a certain condition that the operator can only do it a certain way. And what are the legal requirements that are attached to that in order to have compliance? All of these are associated. And a lot of non-conformances that we see is that people have not taken the time really to go through this properly. One of the issues also is that it's a third party that has conducted this matrix. They have also associated the legals to it. And the ownership is not of the company. The individual that you're speaking to in an audit, and I think we've all been there, you delegate one individual, and if there's an audit, this guy speaks to everybody, but certainly may not be communicated throughout the whole organization. And the other important fact is, the usual downfall is when you change equipment, processes, this has to be updated. So it could be a process change where you have ducting vents in the plant that are moved around. You could be bringing in new equipment. Have you evaluated this equipment? Has there been situations that you'd have to apply for changes in your certificate of authorization? Is there new aspects that have not been there before that are coming out? Are you affecting your next door neighbor? You know, are you putting a chlorine tank outside or whatever the case may be, right? So these are areas that if there are operational changes on processes, it has to be viewed at. And certainly looking at this once per every 6 months or 7 months is certainly not the way to do it. It should be an active matrix, something that you're reviewing on a monthly basis and being fed back into management review at one point. The biggest issue here is you do not have local resources to do these monthly reviews. You have one individual that's probably dedicated to dealing with production, making sure that the line is functional as an operating manager, etc. So the solution, you don't build this matrix by yourself. You should have an environmental committee if you have an ISO 14001 standard certification already, or R2. You certainly do have an environmental committee, even if it's just two people involved. But it should be a participating activity in order to maintain this matrix. And it also should be communicated to employees, general employees, that what are their significant aspects? What are their concerns? So when auditors do walk in, if I pull anybody off the line and say, you know, what here is really hazardous to you? And what kind of controls are in place? And these are the type of questions that we're asking. And also, this should be reported back to management review. So, second side of this, we see that a lot of cases, there are secondary containment issues. And, you know, if you're taking a look at R2, on focus materials, you're talking about ethylene glycol, you're talking about CRTs, the batteries, all of these areas are areas of concern, and they have storage and packaging requirements in order to be legal, right? And in most cases, you know, I have shown photos here of spill containment areas that you can see barrels that are on pallets, or there are also other pallets that have four barrels that can sit in them. If you have anything liquid, oil, diesel fuel, you name it, okay, sitting in a barrel on the floor, to me, it's an area of concern, because there is always an opportunity that this barrel is going to start leaking. And if it does, you have a major leak on your hands. So whether it's ethylene glycol, whether it's oil, whether it's diesel fuel, whether it's hydraulic fluid that you're using for your forklifts, we're looking for how are you storing this? What are you putting them on? And, you know, I've heard the story that, yes, I'm sending batteries out to, could be any type of recycler. I'm not going to name the companies, but and their requirement is we just put them on a pallet and it's fine. But it is your responsibility to assure under transporting of material, dangerous goods, materials, that whatever leaves your plant until it gets to the point of discharge, you are responsible for it. So if there is any major leaks along the way, you're not signing that material dangerous goods material waybill for nothing, okay? And you don't need the required training for nothing either. It's a requirement. And certainly if something does happen between your plant and where it's going, if the truck doesn't have placards and they require placards, you are going to get fined, right? So all these areas are a concern, and an auditor looks at this, okay? Yes, we do have a vision, an overall vision, and we're not going to be asking you the impossible either, but there should be some type of containment. So one, you need to have some type of secondary containment for all stored hazardous liquid materials and lead acid batteries on the floor. You also have to have some way of how are you securing and storing your fluorescent light bulbs if you do get them, which you should basically be having some of this. They contain mercury and they're seen in scanners, et cetera. You also have your lighting, your fluorescent lighting in the offices that you're recycling back. All these light bulbs are very difficult sometimes to ship. And we have found ways in almost like an egg crate type of situation that you can package them and sandwich them in between, strap them and send them out. Other companies have other ways that they'll send you their own packaging in order to return for recirculation. What we see next is dealing with hazardous materials and health and safety, because I've been talking about the environment here, but I'm talking both sides. And it's not like an ISO audit where I'll be going in for ISO 14001 environmental, and I'm not going to look at the health and safety. It's not in the scope of the actual audit. When you go for an RQO qualification audit, and you have the R2 side of it coming into play, you have the health and safety, because even R2 says that you have to have environmental and health and safety management systems in place. So you don't necessarily have to be OSHA 18001. However, you have to have a system in place that guarantees the actual health and safety of your plant facility and your employees, right? So it means what are the min-max levels of time in storage? And this is sometimes included in your certificate of authorization. And I'm talking Canada here. I mean, in the States, you do have it. You have state bylaws that will require you to report what your inventory levels are on, I believe it's on a yearly basis. The same thing in Canada. You also have approved downstream suppliers. You can't send this to anybody. So now you have to approve your downstream suppliers to the actual program, right? And they should also have systems in place that comply with all this. We're looking at how the materials are controlled. And also, in that case, what actions are taken to prevent employees from exposure? So this is kind of a, you know, a hit and miss situation, because you may be regulated to do something, and in certain cases you're not, but you have to take actions in order to prevent your employees from definitely getting either injured or at the same time exposed to certain elements. In non-approved recyclers, sometimes these issues don't come out because they're not regulated the same way. And I think that's the reason why that we're not all on the same basis, same platform. It costs money to be approved. It costs money operationally to be approved. There is a cost to join the team, okay? And in doing so, though, that you're becoming an environmentally friendly corporation, you are securing the health and safety of your employees, and you are not getting this materials into landfill, which is basically the top priority for any standard, whether it's R2, E-Stewards, or ISO. On the hazardous material health and safety side, you know, the first impression is always the first, the thing that we see, and it's the first 5 minutes of walking into a plant facility. Okay, how are you greeted at the front door? Are you told what are the personal protective equipment that you require to be access to the plant? Are they looking at you first of all to sign in on a guest registry? Are you told that there are safety glasses required, lab totes, masks, steel toed shoes? I've been in plants that basically you'd have to wear hazmat outfits, okay, in smelters. And, you know, the smelters in northern Quebec. And I remember walking in there with two hazmats, and I asked the question, why? And they said, well, you're going into a smelter, a copper smelter, and then you're going to a sulfuric acid plant that basically extracts the gases, which is just next door. And we're worried about beryllium exposure. So you, after you walk into one, you're going to have to strip down off one suit so you can walk into the next facility. And you had full ventilated masks. So, you know, it's certainly taken seriously, and the exposure is taken seriously. And I'm not saying that every plant is like this, but whether you are a very small plant that are doing material breakdown, or you are a shredding operation, okay, which does probably both, which is a line dedicated to dismantling by hand, and after that you're put into a shredder, there are certain requirements that you need to go through. And people always fail on the mask fit test. If you are providing a mask to an employee, there should be a mask fit test. How well is that mask fitting to the profile of the face of the employee? Is it the right mask for the employee? And I'm going to be asking, as an auditor, when's the last fit tests that were done? And notably, that employees that are wearing beards, mustaches, et cetera, anything that can interfere with the seal of the mask is certainly not going to pass. And we are looking for these as far as evidence that you have done your due diligence as far as your employees are concerned. We also see that there's annual blood tests against lead exposure, and that should be done not only on a primary shred facility. I think even when individuals are actually touching old laptops, could be old towers, anytime they're getting their hands dirty with all this old dust. A lot of these computers, a lot of these televisions, etc., have been sitting for ages in either a facility. And certainly the dust itself may lead to complications. Okay. As far as, I had one case, even as a primary shredding facility that I was involved with, where we couldn't figure out why this employee had such high lead levels, only to find out, and I said it in one of the articles that I wrote, that basically I caught him smoking outside with his gloves and his mask down. But just the exposure of the gloves that he had to the cigarette was enough to promote a higher level of lead in his body. So these are things that you would never think of, okay? But you have to be vigilant enough to look at. We also look at noise decibel testing within the plant, and usually around 80 decibels or less. Do you need earplugs in certain locations? Do you need even muffs if you have to go even further? We look at the water tests for lead management, okay, and including, a Zamboni going around cleaning the floors. What are you doing with this water? And certainly I'd ask you to show me your water tests for lead or cadmium or beryllium exposure if you're flushing this down the municipal sewer system. If you do have the tests and basically they are within permissible limits, then fine. We're also looking at if you wash your employees' clothes on site, if you have washers and dryers there. I mean, all these clothes do have lead contaminants. You would have to also prove to me, okay, that there's no lead contaminants in order for you to discharge into the municipal system, which these things certainly, you can be the highest approved primary recyclers around. I think you've all seen that, and somehow this comes back, and these questions are still very real even today. Okay, we look at annual air testing for contaminants. Do you need to have a dust collector system in place? One way to get around that, and if you're a small facility, is you do basically, there's test kits out there that you can do swab tests to prove to me that yes, we have done this, we're fine, okay, there are no issues, all right? And that way, we're looking for evidence. We're not looking to find if you're out of compliance. We're looking at two ways: are you compliant with the process? Have you thought about your risks? And ISO 14001 2015 right now deals with risk management. So does quality, the quality standard as well. And this risk management never used to get up to the top directors area. Now it's front and center, and probably it'll be a very focal point on your management reviews. How have you assessed the risks? What kind of risks do you have? There's interested parties in this. I mean, your next door neighbors, et cetera. So all these tests and on hazardous materials is there for a reason, okay? It's showing us that you have a system in place to protect, whether it's on the environmental side or on the health and safety side. And that's why we also look at the housekeeping. And, I know that I'm probably talking to a lot of individuals out there saying, yeah, that's about the hardest thing to keep is the place clean. Employees have habits of throwing things in corners, in the front of doors, pallets stacked up, okay? I'm showing you areas there. One photo on the top is outside. It's an external. So we don't only look on the inside of the facility. We also look on the outside of the facility around the areas, because we certainly don't want to have any leaching, okay, of lead or mercury into the actual environment around the plant, okay? We look at what's happening in the plant. The bottom part there is you see material lower. It's not clean. So how can an operator get up there? Possibly he can even trip, right? We're looking to see if the alleyways are free from obstructions. We've had cases I walked in, they had basketball hoops in the middle of an alleyway, okay? And the forklift could probably have maybe 2 inches to get around it. And I asked the question, why is that here? Well, on our breaks, we like to play basketball. I said, okay. So meanwhile, you're not on breaks right now. So the suggestion was to remove it and put it into a secure location and play your basketball after hours. Certainly, it wasn't the area. I mean, I'm looking for free obstructions in case of fire, in case of anything that happens that you have to evacuate, you'd be able to do that. We also look at the fire exits. A lot of times people start, they say, okay, I have a 20 pallets that I got to put someplace and we're going to store it there temporarily. But unfortunately, the temporary thing never works out. Electric panels protected, you need 3 feet from the actual protection, from the panel itself, from any chargers for forklifts, etc. Normally, what you would put is guards 3 feet from that panel in order to eliminate any possibility of a forklift going into it. So I'm looking at the building codes. Okay, so we are, as auditors, we have the full gamut. We're not just looking at one very specific areas. Inadequate control over, as I said before, over contractor and visitor management, I think is a very common reason for non-compliance. And I think a very simple solution would be a guest register to sign in and out. You have to control who comes into your plant. You don't know if they're coming in with hazardous materials, your contractors. There are softwares available, such as iVisitor and all that, where they have to log in beforehand, and basically it's a barcode type of situation, and they present themselves at the front desk, could be a security guard, etc. And if you're not in the system, basically you don't get into the building, right? You don't have to go to that extreme, but you do have to control who's coming in and who's going out, okay? We're also taking a look at what's the security of the building. I mean, do you have cameras there? If you have garage doors open in the summertime, let the breeze come in, and certainly in the U.S. southern states, that's in 100 degree Fahrenheit weather. If you don't have air conditioning inside, that's going to be pretty hot. In Canada, we still get pretty hot. And I've seen that the garage doors are open in the back. This contravenes the whole security thing, because you may have customers that you take material for destruction or data destruction. And they don't want to have garage doors open. So if you do, you have to have some type of grid situation where you can have airflow, but it's still protected. And it also protects not only people coming in, but also employees handing stuff out. Okay. And I have had cases, personal cases that we've known of, anything's possible. Okay. Certainly we've had 40-foot trailers backed up to the door with the back trailer closed, but not locked. Somehow somebody managed to get in between the wall and the trailer. Okay. So, if there's a way for anybody to get into certain products, this is a commodity, they will find it. And that's the reason why security of the building inside, outside is very important. And one of the last points where most companies, not recyclers only, but all companies, you have trailers going back and forth coming into the building. One of the first things I'm going to look at is if the trailers have been shocked. And you can see at the bottom what shocks look like. And that's to prevent movement of the trailer. We don't want to have any accidents. We don't want to have the guy pulling out and the forklift going in between the trailer and the building. We have seen that. A lot of companies will request that their drivers submit the keys to the actual truck inside, so that's to assure that he's not going to start up the cab and move it. I think it's a good practice. I don't say that you have to do that. But certainly the minimum requirement would be to have the actual wheels shocked. And we do look for that. Contingency and closures. I mean, one of the, interesting points about all this is that in order to operate, we want to make sure that you stay in business. And if you do go out of business, how are you going to protect the material that you have? And most standards or programs will require you to have some type of a contingency plan and closure plan in place. And it's required on the capacity, square footage. It's also to require you to have a certain amount of environmental insurance and a security bond. And the security bond is based on size of operation, what's your capacity levels, how much it's going to cost you estimated to get rid of this material if you walk away tomorrow. And we've seen, and the reason for that is that that came about on the Canadian side, okay, that there was cases that the old CRTs, television, et cetera, it was stockpiled outside of a company. And I'm talking about a lot of them, a lot, because you know there's no value in that. It costs you money to break down CRTs. It costs you money to break down old television sets. You're certainly not making revenue from this. So this is not your high priority, and you'll stockpile it somewhere until you get to that point, or you will not even get to that point. And in this case, he didn't. He was given, I believe, a fine at the very beginning, never did anything, but basically walked away. And it cost the Ontario government, I think at that point, the program, over $1 million to clean up that very small area that he had stockpiled all this, because now you have ground saturation as well on dangerous material. So the reason that this came out is that they were thinking, okay, guys, how can we protect ourselves in case people do walk away? And that's the reason for this, okay? So the contingency plans is not necessarily only in the case of you walking away. What happens if you have a fire, okay? What happens if your roof caves in because of snow or you're flooded, okay? What is your contingency plan? What are you gonna do with the material? What are you gonna do with your operations? Because materials can, if you're part of a program, you keep on receiving material every day. So where is this gonna be sent to, okay? And sometimes you're making deals with your competitors in order to safeguard the environment. If we're going to the next area of emergency preparedness and response, this is another highlight of your non-conformances. What we see is a lot a case lack of spill drills from the fuel in the docking areas or hydraulics or processing equipment. People don't really do this type of drill activity on an ongoing basis. And I would suggest that, you know, probably associated with your evacuation drill you do for fire, do it the same week. But there's not only that that we look at, is that are you really prepared for an emergency response? And it's not necessarily spills. What happens if you have propane tanks outside or your neighbor has propane tanks outside? So we'll look at the building. Around the building, what are, and again, this should be reflected back into your significant aspects or your risks for health and safety, is that it should already be on that list that you have a potential area where you're going to have a potential disaster. Okay, how do you prepare for it? So there may be a number of different ways. There may be evacuations. You may, you know, in certain cases, I was dealing in magnesium and die casting. We had our own fire department. You know, magnesium is very volatile. I mean, you're dealing with as soon as it hits air, you have a fire. So we were more equipped than the local fire department, and we had our own response team. I'm not saying that you need to do that in this case, but as recyclers, you should be assessing your risk and you should be assessing what's surrounding you in order to eliminate any possibility. And you should be going through exercises in that regard if there's any special requirements that you need. So far we've been going through quite a few things, and I'm going to get to operational challenges that we have here. And I think, you know, based on the time, if we go into details, it's never going to get through. So I'm going to try to make it an overview. It's not easy being an electronic recycler. And certainly the programs administer material by a bid process. You're creating, whether you're small operations or large operations, you certainly have a business plan and you have to define which way am I going to go. Am I going to be doing manual dismantling? Am I going to be going on a primary shredding side? And it's almost like you're a chemist in a lab somewhere trying to figure out what's the nature of your final product that's going to come out. What can I sell? With only one problem, is that you never know what you're going to get. So the material mix is vastly different, okay? And with that comes what kind of equipment. And, you know, I've seen both sides. You know, certainly I've been involved in the operations of a national corporation, Electronics Recycling Corporation, and we try different things, okay? We tried it with a spoken hub operation where you'd be dismantling by hand. In certain locations, you're transporting that to be shredded, okay, at a centralized location. all this material is coming in on top of program material, but you have to be able to take products off the shelf, equipment, and set up a plan and set up basically a line with the idea that what kind of capacity, what kind of footprint that I need, what are the transport requirements. The challenges are very many because you're trying to balance the line. You're trying to get a certain output and throughput from this. In certain cases, you may have a shredder operating at X metric tons per hour, and these conveyors and the other equipment are not calibrated. They're not even speaking the same language, okay? There will be bottlenecks. So now you have to go into PLCs. You have to be able to support the line in such a way that your process flow is balanced, right? The only problem is sometimes when you're buying things off the off a catalog, you really don't know what the true capacity of that product is until you get it to operation. I have put a couple of samples here, you know, basically from anything being into a chain shredder, and you can see the chain shredder feed line on the left. You can also see the photo of the internal side of the chain shredder, which is like a washing machine, right? And it has chains across it and off a central axis. And basically what happens, material is getting broken up by smacking into each other. It does create issues. Some of the issues does create is that you better have a very good maintenance program, because the sidewalls do deteriorate. Sometimes they're not readily available. Also, the material doesn't break up as much as you would need it to break up. So the operational challenges that you see, that you may end up going to a shaft shredder instead, which I have here on the left, okay? And then, because all this comes to the point is, how much are you gonna shred down to? What is your material breakup? How are you gonna align that with the optical sorting machines, which are eddy currents in order to take off your metal, okay? And sometimes it's not easy. On top of that, your input of materials into that line has to be balanced between plastics and high metal content. If you're just putting plastics through, you're going to squash everything. I mean, certainly on the dry side of it, the screens will start clogging up. There'll be other operational issues as well. You know, so as a company involved with all this, and you're seeing this revolve on a daily basis, you're certainly into a position that you want to start tweaking equipment on the line. So before you do that, I think some of the challenges is that you have to take a look at, you know, what are your business plans here, okay? Do you really want to get into manual dismantling? What is the potential for the line? You have to take a look at what's the layout of the production line, capacity. And the other thing is, who's my upstream, downstream suppliers? Where's the material going? Where am I going to get it from? What are my legal requirements? How large a facility is required? And I've seen facilities on manual side dealing from anywhere between 10, 15,000 square feet. So you can do this in a small box. Data destruction capacities and capabilities. What kind of software are you going to use? Kill disk, Blanco, et cetera. I mean, how many disks at a time do you want to do? What are the reporting measures on that? How are you going to show me that this data has been destructed as it should be before you go into a reuse side of it? Okay. And refurbish for sale. Do I want to have a retail situation, or am I going to sell it to somebody else that's going to do that? The amount of considerations for that is a lot less than if you were a primary second facility. Okay. As a primary, you're going to have both. And, you know, honestly, I think from my own personal experience, you can start a manual dismantling operation for easily under $100,000. Okay. You can't do that with a primary. You're probably talking anywhere between $5 and $10 million, depending on your capacity. And the bigger, the better. The bigger the building, the better. And I always said that since day one, because you have to stage the materials. You have to pre-sort the materials. You have to get into a line that can accept enough of the throughput. You have to be able to get your material out, and you have to be able to stage that for delivery as well. So, you know, I had 80,000 square feet, and I can tell you the 80,000 square feet was, there wasn't too much to spare. So the challenges that we have that I've had, and I think that most of you have or have had, is that is the mix of materials as input. Okay. Also, approve downstream suppliers to receive the output. A lot of times, the programs will not tell you who the downstream suppliers are, and you'd have to go out and find them yourself. The throughput and yields as estimates, it's only estimates. Okay. We're like chemists in a laboratory trying to do something, but not necessarily are you going to get what you think you're going to get out of it. Location, facility, the zoning, the equipment integration, equipment has to talk to each other. Okay. So your PLCs, your complete programming of this is important. Your compliance demands from e-waste programs, your packaging, data destruction requirements, et cetera, and your employee onboarding, your training, your safety programs. So far, I've been going into that area, and I'm saying this, okay, what are the trends? Where are we looking at? Well, individuals are keeping their electronics a little longer than they used to. And what's happening also is that recyclers in the U.S. I've seen is that the old style TV tubes, monitors, televisions, which haven't been sold for years, okay, are still being stockpiled in certain areas. People are not bringing it into a recycling situation. So what we're seeing in Canada, a lot of this material has already gone through at the very beginning of the electronic recycling phase when it first came up on the programs. In the U.S., because they're lagging a little bit, a lot of this equipment is still there. Which is also creating issues of finding downstreamers for this glass, such as CRT tubes. A lot of the leaded glass that came out of this was recycled into new CRTs. Okay, nowadays we're not making them any longer, so the actual downstreamers are starting to dry up on that. So we have to look at a little bit better technology, possibly, or be able to secure your downstream suppliers as soon as possible, including their capacities. So your relationships with your downstreams become a very important relationship to build and keep. Also, we can see that the commodities market for ferrous materials, copper, they've been fluctuating quite a lot of time, you know, and we have to realign our business plans, become more creative with processes to extract precious metals. The newer electronics are harder to extract. I mean, with the rare earths and everything else, I mean, I know we tried it and we weren't very successful. The technology that you need is exceptional. Unless you're smelting, it's not going to be a very good percentage on yield. So you can possible hedge commodities in the market. In order to do that, your grade has to be good and you have to have the volume, right? If it's not large enough, then basically there's no real advantage of hedging at that point. Also, we need to see that legislation in the U.S. needs to be a little bit more harmonized. So transporters, you know, recycling transport e-waste across borders to other states that have little e-waste legislation. I mean, the playing field is not even for those in the U.S. who are approved recyclers. They paid their price to do so. And basically, they're at an unfair advantage at this point with the constraints. One reversal of that is also the Ontario Electronic Stewardship, OES. They were directed to wind up just recently. This is hot off the press. And this program was harmonized under EPRA. And you can see that, you know, here's a case that we were harmonized across Canada. Now there's going to be a gap in 2020. So they were basically told to wind down and it's being taken over by the Resource Productivity and Recovery Authority. Where the difficulty in this is that it's not a surprise that this has happened. Allocations in Ontario have been all over the place. I think they've changed about three times in 5-6 years. And certainly electronics recyclers weren't happy about how things were allocated. And right now, I think basically the Ontario government had enough and said, okay, we're winding it down. And in discussing this with my contacts at the RQO side, I think it's the trend is coming that probably there will be paying the recyclers after they process. So I'm going to declare that I process this, it weighs so much, then I'll pay you. Okay. However, by anticipating that type of remuneration change based on capacity, on what you're actually doing, rather than allocating in advance, the smaller companies are going to be disadvantaged on this, because the larger corporations already have the connections on maintaining equipment and materials coming in. Okay, so they have the connections on input materials. They're going to go out and grab it. They may grab it from other provinces. They'll bring it into that area, into Ontario, and they'll basically process it, declare it, and get paid. Where the smaller companies who used to count on allocations from the Ontario government will probably be disadvantaged. There is no danger here. That program still staying in place until 2020. There will be something to cover e-waste, although the actual nature of the organization hasn't been identified at this point. So the industry is far from being stable. Okay, we also have challenges with complex plastic materials coming in, such as nanoparticles. We don't know how to basically use this. I know that Mike Biddle has been dealing with this for a long time as a plastic specialist, and people in the industry know of him. Certainly, even he has difficulty in trying to figure out which technology we're going to be using in order to apply these materials. A lot of OEMs have started to recycle their own plastics and looking at future designs and recycling technologies. And you also start to see more partnering going on with downstream and upstream suppliers to secure business plans as this trend becomes basically more miniaturized, okay, over the next little while. And we can start seeing that, you know, the technology for e-waste extraction needs to start keeping up. There are also the automotive side, where you're going to start seeing more car metal recyclers getting involved in e-waste recycling due to the nature. And in that case, you're seeing the new Mercedes electric car. So it poses other problems, because you have the electricity of the car, you have the batteries, you have different type of composites, not necessarily metal anymore. You have all the electronics. What are you going to do with all this? And I don't think most of the car manufacturers have thought it out yet. I know that, you know, they'll probably start creating their own circle for recycling on their life cycle approach, and that may help. The last area, and I think I'm trying to get on time here, I mean, we're not doing too bad, is legal requirements. And this is a very difficult area. I mean, you know, most people have compliance audits every 3 years, and they set up their legal registry. And we find that, how do you handle this in between those 3 years? So you have an external audit company that comes in, does your whole compliance audit, sets up your whole legal registry, whether it's your state, municipal, federal side, whether it's US, Canadian, okay? But who's handling this on an ongoing basis? And that's where we find that there is a gap, okay? Because in health and safety, a non-compliance is a non-compliance. You are not compliant, which may lead to repercussions immediately. So if there have been changes in the laws and you only find out about it 8-9 months later, then you are out of compliance. On the environmental, the impact is still there, but you know, may not have the same impact on a health and safety side, but on an environmental side, it does as well. We need to find out, how are you handling these changes on an ongoing basis? And, you know, and attaching it to your risk analysis. That's the important point of it. And I know that, you know, smaller companies sometimes have challenges with this because they don't have enough resources to do this. And I think, you know, as part of my solution anyways, I know that I am a Nimonik user. I've had personal experience with the software. I'm satisfied, but you still need to have the personnel around you that are going to do this verification. And we find a lot of non-conformances that come out on this as well, because we have been up to date. And the idea here is to be able to take this, bring it into your registry that affects your significant aspects, your control points, and it's all related. So I hope I've given you an overview of the electronics recycling industry from an auditor's perspective and from an operational perspective. I know that I can go probably into detail on each one of these sections, but we wanted to do is give you an overview of these areas. And I thank you for your participation today.
Well, thank you so much, Ronald, for all the information. Personally, I was quite surprised to learn that electronics recycling has such challenging operations. Oh, you launched a poll, Ronald?
Yeah, okay. I just did it now, but
Please participate in the poll. I think you have the results here, Ronald.
Let me take a look. 29% Canada, 42% United States, 12% Europe, and 14% other. So that's great.
Yeah.
I'm going to launch
another poll.
The other poll that I have here, let's take a look here.
Let me close the poll and you can launch again. Okay, here you go, Ronald.
Okay, so here we go. So let me just bear with me on this because it's new to me as well. So
don't worry about it. You have people participating. What's the importance of the life cycle approach, Ronald? Like, why exactly do you want to know?
Because it's new to ISO 14001 in the way that it's very central to the core environmental standard. It used to be there, but it used to be indirect, okay? And this life cycle approach, what it does, it puts you in the context of the scope of operations of your company. So what are you doing? How are you influencing? What are you controlling? And it can be used basically from anyone that has ISO 14001 or R2 or either or. But the important part about it is that it encompasses R2 and ISO 14001 in this. And I think it's probably the only time I've seen that approach on paper. Okay, it's, that shows it very explicitly and describes it very well, that you can use that basically for an auditor and say, well, these are the areas that we are impacted. And this goes back to your environmental aspects as well. Before, we never had anything that was tangible that you could actually see and communicate. And you can use that communication to your employees, which is very important, because now they see what they can control and what they cannot control, but they can influence, and how all this attaches to each other.
Well, we have the results, Ronald. 81% professional said yes, and 19% said maybe. Nobody said no. So do you have any comment on the ones who said maybe?
Well, it all depends on the context that you're using it in. I mean, maybe not everybody is ISO 14001. Maybe not everybody is a registered recycler, okay, under a program. So the impact may not be there right now. But if you are moving to becoming a certified recycler, and in Canada anyways, then you're going to be using ISO 14001, the program, the standard, as well as R2. And if you're in the U.S. and you want to become, certified to a standard, it will serve you under E-Stewards and R2 as well. So I can see maybe that, it maybe is, because maybe it's not clear for the context of your organization right now and where you are. But in either case, I'm happy that nobody said no anyway. So at least I am clear on how I presented. So
okay. Perfect, Ronald. Thank you for the webinar, Ronald. You can take a sip of water and get ready for the question and answer round. We have a couple of questions for you here. Okay. So everyone, I hope you found the information useful. It's now time for question and answers. Please do not hesitate to ask any question you might have. And in case you decide to leave before the end of the question and answer session, please remember to fill out the review at the end with a few multiple choice questions. It'll just help us improve to provide you better information. So before I take the first question, I would also like to quickly point out that Nimonik would love to be part of your efforts to improve your regulatory compliance. We are conducting a demonstration tomorrow in case you would like to see our software. You can give us a call or you can even send us an email to schedule a demonstration. We are happy to do that. Or you can simply sign up for our 20 days free trial account, in which case we will contact you on our own. So with that in mind, we will tackle a few questions in the sequence they were received. So the first question, Ronald, is CHWMEG finds that many e-scrap processors, many of which are R2 and E-Steward certified, cannot demonstrate with any evidence that they have a downstream due diligence process. Please comment.
Okay, so they're saying which just repeat it for me for 2 seconds.
CHWMEG, I'm not sure what that is, finds that many e-scrap processors, many of which are R2 and E-Steward certified, cannot demonstrate with any evidence that they have a downstream due diligence process. Please comment.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen this before because it's always a comment from E-Steward saying that R2 doesn't have an ironclad way of due diligence for your downstreamers. You can still send to Europe, etc. There's ways of getting around it by saying that your reuse equipment, your equipment that you're sending is reusable and therefore doesn't constitute a hazard, okay, or e-waste potential at this point in time. I can take it from both sides, even the e-stores, okay? If there's a way that you want to find to get around the system, you're going to try to get around the system. That's a certainty. However, I can tell you that as an auditor, and I've gone through R2 with SGS, okay? And I can tell you that I had to go right down to end of life cycle on it. A lot of downstreamers do not want to provide you with that information because they consider it proprietary. And they do not want to disclose. I tell you that I got around part of that by having SGS contact them themselves, doing the audit, performing the audit at the downstreamer, and sharing back with the program administrators, okay? Not the actual primary recycler in order to guarantee anonymity of the downstream. Now, this is a drastic case, okay? It's not happening all the time. Normally, you do see this, though, and that's the reason why you have to go after a number of different downstreamers. Certainly, if you're dealing with downstreams in China or India, it's a little bit more difficult to do your due diligence. You may not be able to track. But I can say that on both sides of the coin, either R2 or E-Stewards, there are gaps. And certainly, if you want to get around the system, you can. It's just, you know, that you have to prove to me as an auditor that at least you've done your due diligence to as far as you can get, at what point you can get on the life cycle approach. Okay.
Thank you, Ronald. I'll take the next question from Elizabeth. Can you provide the reference for the 3 feet clearance of battery chargers from electrical panels? Is it an NFPA requirement?
It's a building code requirement under Quebec. I don't have the exact clause on that, but if you take a look at the building code that we have here in Quebec, and it's in Canada across, I believe the same thing happened in Ontario, that there's a 3 foot clearance between the electrical panels and charging units. And if you, unfortunately, I don't have the exact code in front of me, but I certainly can get back to you on that. We can find it.
Thank you, Ronald. Another question. So this one's from Brian. What actions can a company take to protect the environment and from a liability perspective when using e-waste suppliers? In the current state of the e-waste industry, to what level of due diligence should a company take on-site audits, desktop audits, etc., to ensure certified companies are meeting their obligations?
Okay, it all depends if your e-waste is, if you're sending material to an e-waste provider or this e-waste company is part of a program, okay? But in either case, in order to protect the environment, that's the reason why we have national professional programs established in Canada, and also why 50% of the US states also have some type of regulations, is that we have to protect the environment. We don't want stuff leaching into landfills, okay, off CRT tubes, mercury tubes, you name it. So as far as I am concerned, what we have done in Canada and harmonizing across the board, to give you an idea, before, if you were not harmonized and you had each province having their own programs and they had their own downstreamers, they would not share who the actual downstream suppliers were. So that means that you had to go out, requalify this. If you had five plants across Canada, for each plant location, you would have to requalify your suppliers with that specific standard, program standard, which made it very difficult for the downstreamers, because a lot of these guys said after first time, like, I don't want to get audited 150 times in 6 months. So the harmonization kind of helped that a little bit, because basically then there was an approved downstreamers on there. Okay. The compliance audits that are done as part of ISO 14001, which is the basis for the ERP standard, that's what the platform was, requires you to have compliance audits done at least three times, at least once time every 3 years. So this compliance audit is third party. Companies like WSB would go in and they would actually conduct an environmental compliance audit on your facility, okay? And those actions had to be closed off, and they would be reviewed by me walking in order to comply, to have you comply to the actual standard. If you didn't close off those issues, depending on how big those issues are, then you wouldn't be an approved recycler. So there are methods that are in place, and we are doing this in order to protect the environment. And we're not only carrying it to the e-waste recycler companies themselves, we're taking that and we're bringing it right down to the downstreams. So we're going to end of life. And that's the reason for R2, E-Stewart's, EPRA, okay? ISO 14001 doesn't go far enough. It sets the standard for the environmental side, but it doesn't set the standard for the life cycle, end of life status of the actual parts you're dealing with.
Okay, perfect. Thank you, Ronald. Just a comment to the attendees. We know we have gone a little bit over time, but I think it's a great opportunity since you have an RQO auditor right there to answer your questions. So please feel free to send in your questions. Do not hesitate. And with that in mind, another question from the first question from Gary. Data destruction at customer sites is growing as risks of data breach alarms business. Destruction of data media varies from drilling, folding, nails, and shredding. Do you have any recommendations?
I've seen these mobile units all the time. You walk into companies. I mean, what's the best way to do something? Okay. I mean, it all depends on your operations. I think one of the easiest way, if you're in a mobile, I've seen mobile shredders, you know, where you put the thing in and it kind of breaks it up a little bit. I'm saying if you really want to do the job, you drill it in three locations, right through the disk. And then basically at that point, you can't transport it because you're doing this mobile, right? The customer is going to ask you for a certificate of destruction anyways. And if your customer accepts you drilling, then I would certainly use that. It's an easy way to do it. You put into some type of a jig fixture, okay? And basically with a drill press, you can go down, you know, drill it three times. Nobody's going to read that disk. If you go into certain presses, sometimes you may not get the total destruction of that disk, depending on the power of the press. And if you're on a mobile unit, it's certainly that you may not have the air compressor system, enough PSI to do what you need to do. So it's up to you. I mean, both ways are done. Certainly on the mobile side, it's the easiest way to do it. They want the stuff destroyed at their premises. I would use a drill press. I think that would be the easiest thing. And then after that, you can transport that to a primary shredding corporation. And basically, they would extract, unless you have your own facilities in-house. Then basically, it's a closed loop. You know, and you've secured the transport of this data to your facility because you have destroyed any possibility that somebody can read the disk.
Thank you, Ronald. I hope that answers your question, Gary. I have two questions from Elizabeth. What are the contaminants that would affect soil and groundwater from exposing old TVs or computer monitors?
Yeah, well, you have cathode ray tubes. So basically, there could be a first big culprit in there is lead. You can also have mercury bulbs, okay, associated with it. And on the wiring, you know, believe it or not, we've seen asbestos wiring in the past as protective coatings. So that's the reason why we don't want to see television stockpiled outside. The reason why they are is because they're very hard to tear apart. I mean, with the old wooden boxes, you know, it's very labor driven, and it's probably the last thing you want to do as a recycler is to take these things apart. Okay, so you're going to go after the fast dollars, which is the towers, the laptops, anything that has a high printed board, circuit board content that you can get copper out of, etc. And these old televisions, you know, they're going to stay there for a while because you need somebody to tear them apart, right? So we don't want them to stockpile. And that's how you should be able to at least bring that into your facility. It's illegal to keep it outside, okay? As an RQO auditor, it's an automatic non-conformity to have anything outside that's not protected. You could have it outside under lean-to or whatever the case may be from the elements that ensures me that there's nothing going into the ground contamination side of it. Even then, I wouldn't be too happy about it. Normally, it would have to be protected indoors. Okay.
Thank you, Ronald. I will take a question from Dan before I go back to Elizabeth's question. As a recycling company that utilizes downstream vendors, what is required in our audit pack? Where can one get assistance preparing an audit pack?
An audit pack, meaning that a checklist, right? You're looking for some type of a checklist that you do for your downstreams. I know that there was a checklist for the RQP side of it, okay? For R2, they have a governance, guidance package that's associated with R2. The easiest way would be to talk to your registrar, first of all, or a consultant that you know that would have checklists, okay? I do know there are certain softwares available out there that have a checklist that you can use depending on the programs that you're dealing with. And the checklist only serves as a guide, okay? I mean, the downstreams, what you're trying to do is find out, one, are they ISO 14001? That's the basis. Okay, whether there are R2 or not is secondary. So first of all, to protect yourself, due diligence wise, are you 14001? Because R2 is also asking if you are, that you are ISO 14001. If you're R2, you should have that as some type of a management program. If you're e-stewards, then you can basically be looking at both of those. Okay, so if you take a look at the requirements of the standard, these are the questions that you need to ask your suppliers, okay? One is, what is he doing with the material? How is he destroying this material? Is it being recycled into something else, okay? Who is he sending material to? Is he the point of final destruction, or are there other processes involved after that? So you have to do a value mapping of your material, okay? Where at his point of entry and at his point of output. And all the individuals involved along with it. Also, then you're looking at the health and safety requirements of your downstreamer, okay? Has he had any issues environmentally, okay? Has he had, what's his accident rate within the plant? What's he doing with the material? I mean, the list is lengthy, but I think you can probably bring it down to about 30 questions. I've seen it about 30 questions that you're gonna ask your downstream supplier to get back to you with, including how he transports material, okay? What transporters are you using? It's a difficult question, but you know, sometimes you can't just buy this off the shelf, unfortunately. And I think it depends on who you're dealing with. I'm sure if you're dealing with a consultant, if you're dealing with a third party of some sort, and also if you take a look at the actual standards themselves, will give you enough information to build your own checklist on this.
Thank you, Ronald. That's back to Elizabeth's question. I think this is in reference to the poll question on life cycle. Are you talking about the life cycle approach from the generator point of view or the waste processor point of view?
I'm talking both. So it's not only, you know, I'm looking at the expanse of all this, that you can take it in any context that you wish. From an electronics recycler, you know, you're taking a look at this life cycle and you're saying, okay, what is my product? My product is what I'm receiving, okay? So basically, I have no control, I have influence over the material that's gonna come to me, because am I getting it from a program or am I getting it from private corporations? Is there ways, how can I influence this? Well, there's a way I can influence it by, I don't wanna deal with medical equipment, as an example. Okay, so my input, I don't want to see medical equipment. If I do get medical equipment, it's going to go back to the program managers, okay, or it's going to go basically back to whoever sent me. Okay, so I'm not set up for it, and I can influence what material I can get in, right? What can I control? Well, I can control the atmospheric emissions of my plant. I can also control the liquid effluent that I have. So how do I administer that in the plant? Where it's water, where it's diesel fluid, where I have secondary containment, I can certainly control that. I can control what I purchase and how I manufacture, the equipment that I buy, all right? How is it set up in the plant on the line? That's under my control, all right? So also under that control is, what atmospheric emissions is that plant conducting? What's the CO2 levels coming out of it? Do I need a dust collector? Is it the right capacity? Okay, am I compliant? Distribution, where is my material going to? Where are my downstreamers? All right. Now, the other part of that is use and disposal. Where we have an influence is that this is the due diligence that you are going to conduct on your downstreamers. You need to go, you know, ISO goes to that level, right, on the life cycle approach. R2 goes past that level. R2 goes right down to disposal. So R2 now wants to know, you're not going to stop there on distribution. You are going to basically stop at disposal, end of life. Okay. And that's the difference between the two.
Perfect. Thank you, Ronald. I have a question from Louise. You mentioned that it is an advantage to have a small recycling plant instead of medium or big one. What will be the crucial issue? Portugal is a small country. There is any key minimum size to refer?
No, I mean, usually you can start it off. It depends on your scope of operations. How much material are you going to get? You can certainly start one small plant between 5 and 10,000 square feet. Okay. It's just that, what are your scope of operations? What are you going to break down? What are you going to get rid of? And again, who are you going to give it to? So maybe it's in your interest to take off the cards. Okay. Memory cards and stuff like that. Something that you can high value with, CPUs. Okay. Where you can basically sell immediately. Okay. Or maybe you're into refurbishing the stuff that comes in that you can refurbish and sell. The rest of it, you're not interested. You sell it to a primary recycler. So scope of operations, you could do it within about anywhere from 5,000 to 10,000 square feet, no problem.
Perfect. We have another question here. Please comment on the challenges for the e-scrap processor on the quality and consistency of materials that they receive. Importantly, customers that send them the wrong unacceptable materials and even unacceptable materials commingled in the shipments.
Yeah, I know. I mean, you know, have you ever been where your blue bins that you send your recyclers from your household? I mean, people mix in all kinds of things, right? So they're not supposed to send, let's say, styrofoam. They're going to send styrofoam. I mean, they just throw everything in there, right? We've seen the same thing, okay? That's the importance of, one, your contractual agreements between where you're going to receive from your customers. Okay. A lot of times there's chargebacks. If I have to sort through the whole thing in order to assure that I have the right materials in there, then basically there'll be a chargeback to your customer that you found X materials or whatever that are not usable. Right. A lot of times this is also a health and safety thing. I mean, I've seen a lot of times the the equipment has hazards to employees. Okay, I mean, I found basically at one point live rounds of ammunition. Okay, in one of my plants, we had to get the OPP in order to dispose of it, and luckily, that didn't get into the process of a shredder. Okay, because if it would have, I would have had a nice fireworks display. So, yes, there are, you know, there are circumstances that you do, but that's your due diligence to assure that whatever is going into your line is appropriate for the line. All right. You can always, you know, you can't always count that whoever's providing you the equipment or materials is going to be providing you the materials that are in line with the electronics recycling standard. Okay, I mean, it could be a little different. So yes, I agree. It's your due diligence to do, and there are, you know, it is a challenge. It is a challenge because, you know, how far are you going to go on this? You have to be able to trust what material you're getting in. But, you know, I think if you go through a sampling on lots and do a quick sample on maybe one or two bins that are coming in, just to assure that, you know, the guy has basically followed, there shouldn't be any issues with the rest of the lot. But that's, you know, it goes on basic quality sampling strategy more than anything else. And I'm going to have to almost leave in about a couple of minutes, though, Jessica.
Oh, that's not a problem. We have a couple of attendees here. I think they are all interested in listening to the answers, but I encourage them to ask the questions as well, because right now we don't have any question from the attendees. But I have a question for you, Ronald, if you could quickly answer before I get another question. I was talking to one of our clients, 100% environmental, and the EHS manager there, Sharon, she was saying that it's really hard to actually get information on how to dismantle the material. So do you have any resources that you can suggest probably where they can learn? Because what she says is that she found search everywhere on the internet, but there's even like she attended the R2 training, but there's just no proper process or procedure anywhere on dismantling.
Yeah, well, the thing is, it's very proprietary. So it's almost considered that, you know, you sign your life away when you walk into a recycling plant because they don't want you walking out with any ideas. And it's like a laboratory, okay? I would start with the actual manufacturers, you know, and you know, a lot of times you have to reverse engineer, okay? It's basically done by practice. So there's a starting point. You have to figure out how you know, easy or complex it is to take apart. The only problem is a lot of products from model to model will change, and certainly the way they have been manufactured will change. The actual percentage of content may change. So nothing is identical. You know, the idea is to get somebody who's very, you know, used to taking apart printers. Let them get apart that printers and create a special type of station on that. And then, you know, have somebody else do, I don't know, monitors, and somebody else does laptops, okay? So they get more at ease with each product, okay? But there is no, you can't go on the internet and show me how to dismantle whatever. I guess you could on YouTube. I guess they may have certain, you know, certain areas that they can show you certain things. But there is no e-waste university that you can go to show for an instruction on how to take apart any of these materials, because it's preparatory to every niche company, and they found out the hard way. They basically went through the process of unengineering the product, okay, as best as they could. And it also depends what you're going to do with the product. You know, I mean, you may only need a few components of this product, the rest you're put through a shredder. If you're a manual dismantler, you may do the same thing. You may only take the components out that have value, and then you're going to shoot it somewhere else, okay, to get finalized.
Well, thank you, Ronald. I think I see that more as a business opportunity for anyone interested in giving lessons on how to dismantle. That person's going to make a lot of money.
Exactly.
So, Ronald, we don't have any more questions. So that was the last question for today. And thank you so much, everyone, for asking all the interesting questions. We still have many attendees even at this moment, but nobody has any further questions. And thank you so much, Ronald, for all the information informative presentation.
Well, All right. Thank you, Jessica. Talk to you soon.
Talk to you soon. Please note that we will send you a copy of the slides as well as a recording of this presentation today or tomorrow. And one last thing, please participate in the post-webinar survey, which will be launched as soon as the webinar ends. And check our blog and our past webinars for more information and read a monthly newsletter to stay up to date with EHS trending topics. So one last big thank you to everyone for attending. I wish you a very great day, and we will hopefully hear from you soon. Thank you. Bye-bye.